implementing the last 5 years as part of the strategy. And especially there was intensive efforts to focus on the reform agenda in the last 2 years as part of this transformation in the health sector. And the critical pillars, especially in ensuring this transformation, in the health system, as you know, information is a critical issue. And we have been having different challenges in terms of improving the data that comes through from the different... That brings data from the, in terms of the primary care level up to all hospitals that comes to the regional bureaus and to the health ministry. Of course, it took time to improve, but because now the quality of data is improving, some of the performances seems to have reduced because actually they are becoming more accurate. And that we verify that because previously we have also been doing different surveys to triangulate or compare if the data that comes through the routine system, how does it correlate with the surveys. And we have been looking at previous years a very wide gap in terms of the data that comes from the surveys, which usually are tend to be more accurate because they are done collected data through surveys versus the routine data that comes through the administrative data. But now after we instituted especially this DHIS2 system that also has helped in having a digital also platform, now we're getting more accurate data, and we can see the surveys made last year, for example, have really narrowed the gap between the administrative data that's coming and the survey data. So this is a huge improvement. Of course, it was challenging because, as I said, some of our performances seems to have reduced, but actually we're getting more accurate data. So now we are basing this data to plan our next 5 years, 10 years strategy also relatively more accurately. So what we've been calling this is information revolution, to make sure we have accurate data, but also to ensure that the decisions we make, the strategies we create are also based on the data. So evidence-based decision making or using the data that we have. And when we say using the data, it's not only to use it at the highest level for policy making, but at all facilities, hospitals, health centers, using their own data to improve their service. So requires a lot of work, and it has to become culture, and there is a lot of change in that, but we need to also continue to do more to reach to the vision that we have in evidence-based decision making at all levels. And the other is, I think one thing I can mention is also in improving the healthcare leadership. Leadership is a cornerstone of having any strong system. And particularly for the health system, having strong leadership at all level is a key priority. So in the past, especially a few years, there has been a strong emphasis in cultivating strong leadership, ensuring that the leadership, especially in health facilities, health offices, is by merit-based, so that they have the, ensure that they have the capacity, not appointed simply either by other virtues, but merit-based. So bringing that shift has been one of the key areas, especially in hospital administration, which is really critical, as you can understand. And also cultivating future leaders. One of the big challenges we always see is the high turnover of leadership and the gaps that are created when you have turnover. And especially cultivating young leaders, women leaders, has been given a big priority. We see there is a big gender gap in terms of healthcare leadership. Although in the health workforce, the biggest share is really by women. You know, we have our health extension workers, our nurses, and other health providers overall account for close to 70% are women, the health workforce. But when you come to leadership, it's very few leaders we have a woman. So cultivating more women, bringing more women into leadership and cultivating young leaders has been given a priority. And we had at the ministry started a leadership incubation program to have those people who are ready to take over when other leaders are
changing, so to ensure that we build that capacity and there is no gap in the health system. So these are maybe just to mention few of the critical areas of reform that we have been doing.
Healthcare Extension Service is one of Ethiopian healthcare initiatives, right? How it's going now?
The Health Extension Program of Ethiopia is one of the flagship programs of the health sector that has been also a model for many countries. And throughout the journey of close to 20 years now, maybe 16, 17 years now, it has really become a reason for many of the health achievements that has Ethiopia has achieved in the health sector, because it has ensured the accessibility of health to the community, ensuring that especially it focuses on prevention, promotion of health, but progressively it also has grown to incorporate different health services, basic health services provision to the community at very close to the community. So as you know, our health extension workers, which are close to 40,000, and mostly women, they go house to house to give health education and give some services, but also give station services at the health posts, which are the lowest level of the health system, care system in Ethiopia. So because of that, the access to basic services, the access to health education and promotion had a significant role in improving the health of our communities. And when I'm saying basic health services, these health extension workers have been providing and are providing immunization services, family planning services, antenatal care, and other services which are actually delivered to the community in addition to the education, the hygiene, sanitation education, and other services they give. So these have impacted the child mortality. As you know, Ethiopia is one of the countries who achieved the Millennium Development Goal of reducing child mortality before even the deadline. It has impacted the maternal mortality reduction, immunization coverage, and these are big pillars that have been achieved as a country and attributable to mostly also the health extension program, not only to the health extension, but a big role. But throughout the years, as I said, their role has increased. So last year we had done a national assessment of how the health extension program is going to ensure that we maintain the strong parts and build on or solve such a challenge. So what we have seen is it's still very relevant in providing services to the community, but some of the strong parts have also weakened a bit. For example, the house-to-house visits have declined because now most of the health extension workers are also more burdened in terms of giving different services at the health posts, just to highlight some of the challenges. So currently we have been working on optimizing and reforming the health extension program to ensure that, and also as you know, there's a changing in epidemiology of our country. We still have the burden of maternal child illnesses and communicable diseases, which has declined in terms of the burden, but still is a problem. But also we have the rising issues of non-communicable diseases. So we have to meet the needs of the community. So to ensure that we have a strong community program as well as deliver the package of essential services at each level of the health system, it needs some reform. So we are now currently working to strengthen the services given, especially for the health posts which are a bit far from health centers, because the community can only access easily those health posts. We are planning to make them more comprehensive services and support by adding health workers, additional type of health workers, but for the health extension workers to continue still building on the community service piece, while the others will continue the basic service if they are close to the health center. So it has huge impact in terms of the successes, but also needs some changes to meet the changing demands of the community as well.
What is your overall analysis on COVID-19 in Ethiopia from the day one up until now?
Well, so when COVID-19, the epidemic started in China, once they declared at the end of December, actually as a country, we started our preparedness around the third week of January. We did not wait until corona was detected in the country. So we established our emergency operating center and activated that emergency operating center and started screening at all the airports and borders and started preparing for potential cases that may come in terms of facility readiness, training, and so on. So the first few months we were intensively working on the preparedness and trying to detect and building the capacity in country, like testing, for example. Initially, as you remember, we were testing by sending to South Africa, and we started testing in country beginning of February. So by March 13 was when we detected the first case of COVID-19 in Ethiopia. And the first maybe 4 weeks or so, we were progressively seeing only cases of imported cases that were coming from out of the country, and or people who have contact with those imported cases. And then slowly we started to see some community transmission. We call it community transmission when we have no clear evidence of any contact or any travel history. So we started to see few cases in Addis, few cases in other regions. And maybe around, it was around May that we started to see cluster of many cases of community transmission, especially in Addis. So progressively we have seen that at least in all of our regions, we see some degree of cases, although very small in number in other regions outside of Addis. We see some degree of cases of community transmission, but to see, we have seen a definite cluster of community transmission. What we have identified is in Addis, that we definitely have community transmission in Addis, but for others, there are sporadic cases of community transmission, mostly are related to those who come through the different borders of the country. So while we're doing this, of course, we in parallel have been building the capacity of the how to manage the cases. The detection is one. For any outbreak, the main strategy is to detect early and to contain as much as possible. So for the detection, building the capacity of our testing, we currently have around 47 labs that are testing all over the country, with maximum capacity of testing of around 11,000 now. Of course, our actual testing has also grown to up to 7,400 the past few weeks. And our aim is to continue growing this capacity to at least up to 14,000-15,000 per day and manage to test as much so that we can really know the status of the epidemic, because our testing determines how much we know about the status of the epidemic. It also determines to help us contain the transmission as well. So at the same time, we also have been expanding COVID treatment and isolation quarantine centers in all over the country. And as you know, the main critical piece of our response has been the coordination, the multi-sectoral coordination and the high-level coordination. So the as a part of the response around late February, our Prime Minister established the National Ministerial Committee to lead this overall response, because any such epidemic or pandemic cannot be coordinated by the health sector alone. It requires a whole of government response. So that's what we immediately did as a country. And several subcommittees led by different sectors, ministers, were established to ensure that we have all the resource mobilization, the communication, and all pieces coordinated strongly. And at the same time, also our government also, in addition to preparing the health aspect, the lab, the hospitals, and so on, the immediate response or action on instituting non-pharmaceutical interventions, like closing of schools, prohibiting mass gatherings, and so on. These were quickly intervened as soon as we detected the first case, in few days after the detection of first cases. And this has contributed, has played a huge role in terms of minimizing the spread of the disease in the country. And this also continued until we also had the state of emergency announced, which made these interventions much stronger. But at the same time also, the response was not only the government. The whole community has also responded in terms of supporting the vulnerable population, in terms of volunteering to educate the community through media or through different campaigns. So it was, and also the private sector, other actors also have reacted by contributing either financially or giving facilities for isolation centers or supporting the vulnerable population through food support and others. So there was a strong solidarity that was seen in terms of the response, which has contributed to the strength of our country's response.
Okay, do you think corona is not gone out of hand in Ethiopia?
At where we are now, where we are seeing it now, as I said earlier, what we know now is how much, based on how much we have been testing, but based on what we see now, the number of cases have not gone as high as it was initially predicted by WHO or others as a continent. And of course, since we are not testing the whole country, so we can only know as much as what we have tested. But what also shows us the severity of the spread of the disease is the amount of days or severe cases you also have. And we have been trying to triangulate the number of days. We may be definitely as a country which does not have a strong days registration system, we definitely may be missing some days. But we also try to triangulate by doing some survey in Addis and around Addis to see in funeral sites, in elders, if the number of cases is really increasing from previous years. But we haven't seen that much a difference, which tells us that we are not at least missing people who are dying from COVID exponentially. So where we are now is not what we can say it has gone out of hand, but what we do after this also will determine how strong we will continue. So our response, both by the community, the precaution measures that every individual takes, and the responses stronger, keeping the response stronger, will determine also how the epidemic will continue.
Okay, Doctor, in the same token, can't we say COVID is not spread out to the community level now?
Well, yes, as I said earlier, definitely there is a community spread within Addis, which we have already documented. And I've said in many of our regions, we have seen some sporadic cases of community spread. But mostly not a big cluster of community spread in the different regions. But our testing has been largely, from the more than 300,000 tests we have done, it has been largely the test predominantly in Addis and around Addis. So the testing in the different regions has to increase, and that's what we are working on now. We have now built the testing capacity, so we need to aggressively increase our testing in all our regions to make sure to say whether we have a community spread or not in as a country. Usually community spread does not equally happen in everywhere. It mostly happens you get epicenters in big cities because of the nature of how we live. So it's obvious why we have seen it in Addis. But that doesn't mean there is no community spread in other regions, so we need to work on further to ensure what is the status of the community spread in all the regions.
COVID-19 is the worst global pandemic. We've been witnessing a large number of fatality and infection rate in the US and some other European countries, right? When it comes to Africa, particularly Ethiopia, we haven't seen that yet. Shall we wait the worst scenario? Where it's over?
In terms of the epidemic curve or how the epidemic is going, what we are seeing now, what we're thinking now based on the projections we have made, is that the epidemic is on the curve or going up the curve currently.
We have reached the peak.
We cannot say we have reached the peak yet.
Yeah.
Based on the different modelings, because there are different modelings that are done, and usually to have a good modeling, you need to have some amount of cases and cases in the community to do good projections. So there were projections that were made much earlier, before we had much cases. The modelings that were made before we had cases or any cases usually will not predict it very well. So the modelings that are done now, when we have higher number of cases and cases, give us a better projection. And currently, we have seen some, because different experts use different modeling mechanisms. Now we're looking through our expert group, we are looking at maybe 3-4 different kinds of modelings and coming, trying to come up with one modeling that will reflect. Some of them estimated very low, some of them estimated very high. But most of them are coming to one area of when the peak will come. Usually, I mean, most of them are suggesting the peak may be a bit later on, maybe around October or after that. As I said, any modeling cannot predict anything crazy, because the earlier modelings that were done a few months back had predicted we may have large number of cases at this time, which we didn't see. So we cannot really rely, but we use them to at least help us for planning purposes. So what I wanted to say is we have not passed it yet,
yeah.
And we feel that our understanding is, yes, it's on the rise, but we're not sure exactly when the peak will come and how high the peak will be. But one thing we also know is strong interventions will make how high it will go lower. So what we call the flattening the curve.
There is a rumor in community. Africans have a better immunity system than that of other European countries and Americans. What do you say about it?
Yes, there are such rumors.
It's not scientific, but it's just a rumor.
Yes. So one thing we have seen, for example, is that the number of diseases, for example, is not as high as has been witnessed in other countries. And we have, the recovery rate is similar to other countries we have seen. But when you see the profile of the cases we have, the highest cases are young population in our case. So in general, young populations would have better recovery than older population. And younger population tend to have less chronic illnesses than the older population. And when you see the disease profile of our country as well, most of them are either older or also have other chronic illnesses. Although we have cases of younger diseases and patients without chronic illnesses as well, but majority are in that line. So maybe the one assumption is that because Africa in general has a young population, that may have helped in terms of not contracting COVID, but in terms of not going to severe or deaths. Otherwise, in terms of contracting COVID, it's similar to both young and old. And as I said, we have the largest group is actually young population that have COVID positive in our country. So this may have contributed, but in general, it's difficult to say that we have a better immunity than other countries. There is no scientific evidence for that. But these are the assumptions we have, is definitely the contribution of the age spectrum.
Some people claim that less attention is being given to other diseases due to coronavirus, right? What is your assertion?
Well, in any such pandemic, there is always a challenge of ensuring prioritizing. So in the beginning, especially when we were in the initial response, everything is new. We want to make sure we are addressing the COVID properly. And also there was fear from the community that if they go to health facilities, they may contract COVID. So from both ends, both from the provider side, from our end, there was a focus on how to deal with COVID, and from the community was having a fear of going to health facilities. So especially the first months or so after COVID was diagnosed in Ethiopia, there was a huge drop in terms of attendance of treatment and outpatient, inpatient cases in different facilities. But we also quickly adjusted to make sure we are addressing both COVID pandemic and also all essential services that need to be provided to the community with equal attention. So the task force that oversees and leads this COVID response has we integrated into to prioritize in essential services that are need to be given priority in this kind of time, especially like maternal reproductive health services, child immunization, patients who have HIV, tuberculosis, and other chronic illnesses. These should not be missing their services and leading to unnecessary deaths that we that is actually sometimes becomes more than the pandemic can cause. So we have been aggressively working with regional bureaus, fast health facilities to make sure we give safely those services. Also, there are different challenges that has improved progressively. So the challenge is there. We have also other outbreaks in parallel with COVID, like measles outbreak and other outbreaks that we are now responding to. As you know, we have been doing the measles campaign recently. So we are trying to integrate and make sure all the other services also are not compromised, but that challenge definitely is there.
Okay, can we genuinely say the current laboratory test shows the current status of COVID outbreak in Ethiopia? Because we are witnessing that the more laboratory tests are conducted, the more positive cases were reported so far, right? Mm-hmm. The less, the vice versa. What do you say about it?
Yes, definitely not. Increasing testing is one of the key strategies to know the status of the epidemic and also act in that regard. So that's why now we have been progressively increasing our testing capacity in nationally, and still we have not stopped yet. Now we have reached a capacity of, as I said, around 11,000, but the minimum with WHO's requirement, we have at least to test around 15,000 in 24 hours. And our aim is to achieve that in the next months or so. We're also procuring large number of test kits. Before this, we have received different donations and also through WHO, CDC and other foundations like the Jack Ma, the Tencent from China as well. So we have been maintaining through that, but now we are procuring large number of tests to ensure that we do massive more testing throughout the country to know really what's the status of the epidemic, to act accordingly. So it's not yet enough. What we are testing is what we are getting in terms of positive cases is based on our tests. So increasing testing definitely is a key to the response.
Once the WHO director said COVID-19 has changed its face to Africa, and Africa would be the hottest spot for the spread of COVID-19. And he added, Africa should wait the worst scenario. Shall we wait for that worst scenario, or it's over?
So the definitely the reason that WHO Director General Dr. Tedros said that was when the epidemic was starting in Africa, and considering the health system that most African countries have, it was bound to bring much more challenge than other countries who have not been able really to also overcome that pandemic's ill effects. So that was expected, and we are still in the pandemic course now. Most countries are still in the rising of the outbreak, but of course the degree of the outbreak has not exponentially grown as was expected. Of course, some of the issues may be related to our testing still, capacity still, but as I said earlier, even for our country, most of the projections, the modelings that we have done are still showing us that the peak may still be a few months away. So we have to aggressively do what we can to stop the spread and minimize the effect of this pandemic or the peak. But the peak may be still a few months away, so we have still to get ready and continue vigilantly to work in the response and the prevention aspect, expecting the worst scenario.
Thank you. Scientists from UK recommended that dexamethasone will reduce the fatality rate of people who are admitted to ICU room. Is that effective in Ethiopia?
So there was a very strong clinical trial that had come out recommending the use of dexamethasone for emergency use for severe patients to improve the severity of the, especially of the effect of the lungs. And based our scientific advisory council, this is a consortium of professional associations which are supporting the response. So the scientific advisory council and clinical advisory groups that we have reviewed this, and we had agreed to incorporate it in our protocol to use for emergency in severe cases who are admitted to ICUs. So to say, is it effective or not, for us, it's very early, because it needs a lot of following many patients as a on the implementation piece, but we have adopted the protocol and have started using it, but we need to have enough data to say whether it's effective or not.
Thank you very much for your time and expertise. I really appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Dear viewers, you have been watching Talk to Obian Show. Thank you for watching. Have a wonderful time.